Namaskar, hello and welcome to NCRT's live phone-in program. My name is Tanvi Khurana and in this social science program, we are going to talk about poverty as a challenge. This is the second part of the same topic. If you haven't seen the first part, I would request you to please go to our YouTube channel NCERT Official and watch the first part of this topic, which is already uploaded on our YouTube channel. All the 9th class students, you're watching us on PME Vidya channel number 9. If you want to know our schedule, our timetable for the rest of the week, then please visit our website Swayam Prabha and CIET. There you will get our timetable, all the details of our programs about the topics, subjects, classes, everything. And we have an expert with us. Let's meet her. She is Professor Jaya Singh. Mm-hmm. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am is from Department of Education in Science and Mathematics, NCRT, New Delhi. And she'll be talking about poverty as a challenge. And I've got a lot of questions. So let's begin with the basic definition of poverty. Ma'am.
Okay. Poverty, it's a multidimensional phenomena. We cannot say there is a poverty because there is a very meager income or the consumption of an individual. It is multidimensional in the sense it includes many things. It includes hunger, malnutrition, limited availability of basic services like education, health. There is also social discrimination, exclusion, and there is also lack of participation in decision making. All these factors contribute towards the poverty. If the person is not having all this, then we can say this person is poor.
Okay. Ma'am, if we talk about the current status of the poor people, what would that be?
Current status, I would say why there has been increase in the number of the poor. First of all, I like to say there has been increase in the number of poor people from 120 million to 150 million. Oh. And the cause is pandemic. Because of the pandemic, there is restriction on the movement of goods as well as the people, and many of them have become unemployment. That has added to the number of the poor. Secondly, in 2018, this is data, 4 out of 5 people were poor in rural areas. And then half of these poor people were children and women. So you see poverty more in children and women. And then there is another data which says 70% of the poor people do not have basic schooling. That is, they have not gone to school at all. Then there are also evidence that poor are found in disturbed and conflict infected areas. This is a World Bank report. And there is a climate change which also has added to the number of poor. Last but not the least, half of the poor is found in sub-Sahara Africa, that is Nigeria, Congo, Tanzania, Ethiopia and Madagascar. Okay. So this is the current status of the poverty. You can see women and children becoming victim of it, climate change adding to the number of the poor, pandemic adding to the number of the poor. So this is what talks about the poverty. Okay. In the current status.
That's the current status. And this data you told us during the pandemic, this increase has happened. So you mean that this has happened in last approximately 1 year?
Well, approximately 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah. 2020, the pandemic began. It's called COVID 2019 because it actually originated in 2019. Mm. And still we are having a pandemic. Suffers.
Okay. Ma'am, if would you like to define new poor to our students?
The nature of the poverty has changed. Now we have a different kind of poor. We earlier we found poor only in rural areas. Now you find poor also in urban areas. Okay. And then earlier they were engaged in agriculture and allied activities. Now they are found in manufacturing and informal sectors. And they are also found in the congested areas of the urban. And again, climate change has added to the number of new poor.
That's very sad.
There are many areas which are now affected by the flood, which were earlier not affected by the flood. Then there are areas which has large rainfall. Earlier that area was dry. So the climate change has actually added to the number of the poor.
Okay, ma'am, what can our country do to, you know, reduce this number and to cut down on poverty?
Yeah, if we have to teach this topic, poverty alleviation programs, then in the classroom we should not confine ourselves to the scheme. But at the same time, we should familiarize learners with the scheme. Some of the scheme I'll talk about. Then if you have to make the class interesting, you must bring out the views of economists as well as social reformers. Mm-hmm. What they have done to eradicate poverty, or what they have done to face the problem. Mm-hmm. So one such scheme initiated by the government is IRDP, that is Integrated Rural Development Programs. This program tries to identify and upgrade the family living below poverty line, and it gives them opportunity through sustainable development. Yes. Then there is another program, Indira Gandhi National Old Age Pension Scheme. It gives pension to the senior citizen who are above 65 years of age. And these senior citizens should not be enlisted in other poverty alleviation programs. Then there is another program called Annapurna Yojana. Here it provides free grain to the senior citizen. Again, there is a program on National Maternity Benefit Scheme. It provides support to the pregnant women. So like this, there are n number of scheme announced by the government, implemented by the government to eradicate poverty.
Okay. And is it helping our people?
Yes, it's helping our people to some extent, but then there is a huge population which is suffering from the poverty, and we need to address them also.
Okay, if we learn from China, they have done a lot of things to eradicate poverty. Can we take some of the tips from them?
Okay, China, here I would like to introduce you to the graph. On the x-axis you have years. That is from 2005 to 2010, 2013, 2015. And on the y-axis, you have regions like Sub-Sahara Africa, South Asia, Latin America and Caribbean, East Asia and Pacific, and last is China. If you go look at the data from 2005 to 2015, you will see not much change has taken place in case of Sub-Sahara Africa. But some change has taken place in case of South Asia from 2013 to 2015. In case of Latin America and Caribbean, which is denoted by yellow, you have a thin strips which remain the same from 2005 to 2015. Then there is another region, East Asia and Pacific, wherein in this graph is clearly denoted the number of poor have gone down. But if you look at China, you had the population had a poverty in China, and from 2005 to 2015 you find the whole poverty has been eradicated. What is the reason? Now let's look at the reason, let's discuss the reason why China could eradicate poverty and other regions have not been able to do so. One such reason was they have a state sponsored programs, and that was very effective in picking the poor out of the poverty. Then they had a very effective early childhood education. You have this early childhood education in our new education policy also. This time there is a focus on early childhood education in our new education policy. And they had China had focused on early childhood education policy in 2000 itself. Then there is the state had quality education as well as healthcare, which other region did not had. Okay. Then there was a cash transfer directly to the account of poor. So there was no chance of leakage of the funds. The poor directly received the sum in their account. And last but not the least, government gave them subsidy to build homes. So they could have home at a very reasonable rate. So I would categorize three main reasons for the spectacular achievement of China regarding eradication of poverty. First was pro-poor growth policies. Second was rural safety nets, that is, they had built on insurance, they had planned subsidies for the poor people, and last but not the least, the government adopted various poverty alleviation programs, which was very effective in eradicating poverty from China.
That's actually great to hear, because with such a huge population, they have managed to do so.
Yeah, of course. And if you have early childhood education, that means you are making your population literate from the very childhood itself.
Yes.
That is why these changes have been suggested in our new education policy, that you educate the child from the beginning itself. Mm. Otherwise, that would help in restricting their dropout from the school. Otherwise, many of them do not find the school interesting and would not like to go to the school at all.
True. That is so true. Hmm. Okay, ma'am, you mentioned in the very first slide of yours that women are more poor than men.
Hmm.
Why is it so? Can we talk about certain reasons behind that, and if we can do something to, you know, improve the situation of women?
Yeah, I would like to take you to Millennium Development Goals.
Okay.
If you look at Millennium Development Goal, it was laid down by UN General Assembly. And here also you will find there is focus on improving the condition of women and child. They said how to improve the condition, it's by empowering the women and, of course, giving more attention to the child. So this was Millennium Development Goal laid down by UN General Assembly, and there are 8 goals among which women have been given a priority. Then there is another goal, Sustainable Development Goal, again laid down by UN General Assembly. Here also they have laid down 17 goals where again priority has been given to women. Unless and until you focus on women, there cannot be eradication of poverty. Now, how is it so? There are n number of studies. One study says if you provide income to the women, you find, it is a study, the women spends income on the family. And there is another study which was done in Nicaragua where they found that the family was fed nutritious food when it was headed by a female rather than a family headed by the male. That is, a family which was headed by female had were provided with nutritious food. That means the family was taken care of, attention was paid to the members that they must be provided with nutritious food. In case of male headed family, that attention concern was not shown to the family members.
Okay.
So these are the two studies. And it's also said that if you restrict women movement, or if you do not allow women to find job outside their house, that means you are restricting their access to their income and other resources. So when they don't have income and other resources in their control, that means they are not contributing to the growth of economic development. So women working inside the house, their contribution is still not taken into account in our national income. Women who works outside or whose products are exchanged for money or for some other goods, their contribution are considered. And it has been found that women who earns money are able to look after their family better than women or the family which is headed by the male.
Absolutely. So this study is, I'm assuming, not just for India, it's for the entire world, right?
Yes, it's for the entire world because the study has been done at the global level.
Okay.
Yeah, and I've cited example of countries,
yes.
Sub-Sahara countries like Nicaragua, Ghana, Congo, where this study was done. The similar kind of study has also been done in India, America, European countries. They found female-headed households are always better than are looked after better than the male-headed households.
Okay, ma'am, there have been certain great minds who have their own views and opinions and perceptions on poverty. Can we talk about Amartya Sen's views on poverty?
Okay, that's fine. Amartya Sen, he got a Nobel Prize, all know that. And his book in, on poverty and famine, and this is a basically an entitlement, essay on entitlement and deprivation. He's demonstrated through experiment that poverty is always man-made. Poverty, there is poverty or there is hunger, not because there is shortage of food, but because there is some disturbance in the mechanism of distribution of food. He cited the example of Bangladesh, where famine took place before independence, and he said, this famine in Bangladesh was man-made, in the sense they did not allow food to be imported from surplus area to the deficit area. The area was infected with the area was affected by famine, but they did not allow food from the surplus area to reach that area. So the people of the affected area were died of famine.
Okay.
So he said poverty is man-made. Now, famine is man-made, and there is poverty, and which also leads to two problems. One is entitlement, and the other is capacities. That is, the poor with low income, they are denied good health, they are denied good education and other basic services. So they are not entitled to many many resources, or they are not entitled to many services which a person with income or good income can avail. And then there is also, you also say in entitlement, that is, they cannot in the sense there is a deprivation of capabilities when there is no income. And and to overcome the problem, he suggested some measures. That is, he suggested that there should be self-employment. Government should provide food security, government should assure employment for the poor, and basic services should be available at subsidized rate.
Okay, so there's no doubt that he's written a very sensible and meaningful book. Okay, that's his views, and we can obviously learn from him. But apart from him, can we talk about Muhammad Yunus's views on poverty?
Yeah, Muhammad Yunus, as we know, he was a professor in a university of Chittagong, Bangladesh. Bangladesh faced famine, then he realized he should do more than the teaching.
Okay.
And in his book, Banker to the Poor, he has cited a very interesting example. He saw a woman who would make a stool out of the bamboo. And when she sold the stool, she got only 2 cents. And that income was not enough to drive her out of the poverty. So he suggested, had there been some reliable source of credit, or had there been some cheap source of fund, then this lady would have been removed out of the poverty. So after looking at this case, he suggested for Grameen Bank. And the, and because of this suggestion and its implementation, he was awarded Nobel Prize. And here he's, there are two kinds of Grameen Bank. One here, which gives fund to the individual, and they're supposed to repay the fund on time. And there is another one where the borrowers, they borrow it from the household. And they borrow not as an individual, but they are a group of borrowers, and they borrow from the household. Since there are group of borrowers, so there is pressure on each of them to repay the loan on time. So he suggested, when you provide cheap credit and timely credit to the poor, they'll be driven out of the poverty. This was implemented in Bangladesh, and this led Bangladesh to remove many of its poor people out of the poverty.
So is this initiative still going on?
Yes. You can see all this kind of initiative in case of self-help group also. Mm. They there are many self-help group who collect fund, mm. and with this collected fund, they tend to give seeds or some raw materials to the members so that they can begin with their own enterprise, mm. and then when they start earning the enterprise, they are supposed to return to the self-help group, not in the form of cash, but from the return return from that enterprise. So these kind of self-help group also helps in eliminating poverty. Yes. There are many of them. In case of India, many of these self-help group have built masks, and that has not only provided masks to the Indians, it has also been exported to other countries.
Okay. That's great, mm. and I hope even our country comes out of poverty very, very soon.
Very soon, because of the self-help group, and more you empower women, more you give them the liberty to work outside the house, the more fast your development would be.
True. Okay, let's go to the next great mind. We have our own Bapu, Mahatma Gandhi. Can we mm. talk about his views, opinions on poverty?
Yeah, Mahatma Gandhi, as we all know, he's the father of the nation. And he advocated that there should be redistribution of wealth between the rich and the poor, so that the gap between the rich and the poor is minimized. And he said that unemployment and poverty should be removed from the rural areas completely, because he had seen the suffering of the poverty in rural areas. Mm. So he advocated the growth of cottage industries, which could provide them with the output, which could provide them with the income, and which could also provide them with the ready-made material. So he advocated for the growth of cottage industries in the rural areas, so that the people of that area becomes independent.
No doubt.
And he also advocated for self-sufficient village. He said whatever you need can be grown in the village. So you have a self-sufficient village, mm-hmm. at the same time you have a cottage industries in your village.
Okay, for eradicating a little bit of dependency, I think in the mm. pandemic times we have started growing our own gardens.
Yeah, absolutely right.
So instead of buying,
there's many kitchen garden.
Many kitchen gardens. Yeah.
They have grown on the terrace also.
Yes.
Yeah, seen terrace farming also, terrace gardening also.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, there's no doubt that we still follow Mahatma Gandhi for his views.
Of course.
What about Mother Teresa?
Okay, Mother Teresa again was a social reformer, mm-hmm. and she also got a Nobel Peace Prize. And very good thing about Mother Teresa was she looked after the child, mm-hmm. or she looked after the person who was abandoned by the family members. She built rehabilitation homes for the beggars so that they could find the shelter around there. She made a very good effort for eradicating poverty, or for giving concerns, love to the poor people in Calcutta. In one of the case, she visited old age home in Calcutta that was looked after by the nurses known to her. So she found that the people in the old homes were provided with most of the comfort, like television, good food, clothes, but they appeared sad, and most of them would keep looking at the door. So she asked her juniors, why is it so? Why aren't they happy when they have all the facilities around there? Mm. So the nurse said, they keep looking at the door with the expectation that their child would come and visit them. And secondly, they don't smile because they feel hurt. So this is how Mother Teresa tried to reach the child, she tried to reach the family, she tried to reach the old homes, and she tried to eradicate poverty from the Calcutta.
We all know that she devoted her entire
life
to children and for the orphans, and she was a great person.
Right? Yeah, of course.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for talking about these great minds and their perspectives on poverty. And if we all do little bit from ourselves to help others, maybe we can too contribute in eradicating poverty.
Yeah. So it's not only income which can remove people out of the poverty, there are other concerns which have been advocated by economists like Amartya Sen, Muhammad Yunus, then and the social reformers like Mahatma Gandhi and Mother Teresa.
Absolutely. Thank you, ma'am, for being here.
Thank you, Tanvi. Thank you so much.
Thank you to all the participants for watching this entire session. Well, this was a great session and a topic we all need to talk about, a conversation much required. So think about it. We all can help. It's not only the money we can contribute. It's the willingness we all need to help others. Thank you. Stay healthy, stay safe, stay indoors and also get vaccinated. Namaste.
Namaste.